He is alive. Yes, he is alive. So let's try this. I'm going to say Christ is risen, and you answer back and say, he is risen indeed, okay? All right. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Excellent. Very good. that's kind of the traditional greeting in the Greek-speaking world. It's all over this time of year. They say Christo Anesti, big signs in front of, you know, what would be the equivalent of Walmarts and, you know, Safeways and grocery stores, Christo Anesti, and everybody says it, you know. It's just, it's cultural, but there's something powerful in saying that, isn't there? There's really something powerful in saying that. In fact, Paul wrote to the Romans, he said, what does it say? The word is near you, in your mouth and in your heart. That is the word of faith that we proclaim. Because if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you'll be saved. You'll be set free. That's pretty good, isn't it? Like, that is so amazing. For with the heart one believes and is justified, and with the mouth one confesses and is saved. It's like, could it really be that easy that I could believe Jesus Christ is Lord and say it? And that would bring me into new life. And I just want to tell you, it is. It's like if we believe in our heart, we trust in our heart. We trust in our heart that Jesus died for us, and we confess with our mouth that he is Lord. We believe that the Father raised him from the dead. We enter into a relationship with God. It's an invitation. It's an opportunity. That's amazing. I think it's just amazing. It's way better than Easter eggs. It's way better than bunnies and chocolate and all the fun stuff we do. Way better than ham dinners. I think we have ham dinners because we're no longer. It's like Acts chapter 10. You know, like, okay, we don't just have lamb dinners, but we can also have ham dinners, and it's all clean, you know, because God made it. So how many of you are glad the grave is empty? Yeah, amen. Me too. Amen. Well, I have a word here on the empty grave and the open heart of God, but I just want to share with you that this morning when I was praying, I felt like the Lord told me he was going to heal hearts and not just, you know, like, bless your little hearts, you know. It's sweet. And God, healing the non-physical heart is massively important to God. But actually, physical hearts, like heart valves, AFib, congestion, all those kinds of things. So I just want to declare that this morning God is here as a healer. He's the resurrected Christ. And Jesus, in his suffering, purchased our healing. So if you have any of those conditions, would you just go ahead and put your hand on your heart, and we're going to release this prayer of healing. And many people were healed in the first service. So, Father, and I want to say this also for those watching online, you know, they're in your living room or coffee shop or wherever you are, just bathrobe, just put your hand on your heart. So, Holy Spirit, thank you that you bring the love of the Father and the Son into our lives. We thank you for this great mystery that through his passion, through his suffering, through his death, and through his resurrection, we're completely saved. We thank you that it was by his suffering that we're healed. His broken body was to make us whole. And so we ask that you would release the healing today, right now, in hearts, in heart valves, in heart rhythms, various enlarged hearts, angina, all of these conditions, that there would be a release of healing, God, that even there'd be a sensation of your presence on the bodies, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. He's good, isn't he? Tiffany's condition 5 years ago, we got this emergency phone call, a number of us did, and rushed there, and we were told And she actually left, you know, she flatlined multiple times in the ambulance, and there was no way to resuscitate her because there was no way to get oxygen into her body. And she had double pulmonary blood clots in both of the arteries that feed the lungs. And they did this emergency surgery on her against all medical wisdom and protocol, and her chances of survival were like 2 in 1 million. 2 people in 1 million with that survive. And they said if she survived, she would be like a vegetable, that she would, there'd be such significant brain damage. And we're glad she's not a vegetable. And then they shoved all these tubes down her throat, and they said, well, you know, if she can function, she'll never sing again. Forget singing. So, hallelujah. He's alive. And because of that, so are we. All right, well, I want to get into my message here. When the grave opened, when it was apparent that Christ was alive, God was opening a dimension of life to us that we could only dream of. Every human being was created in the image of love, for love, and yet in our natural strength, we're not very good at it. We miss the mark, we become selfish, we want what's in it for me becomes a driving motivation, and so every harmful human behavior, every addiction, everything that leads us to the life we don't want stems out of that brokenness in our relationship with God, because we only function when we're plugged in to infinite love. We only function the way we're meant to be supernaturally when we're in communion, when we're in participation with this infinite love and divine life of the Father and the Son. That's what you were created for. And yet by our own weakness, selfishness, Scriptures call iniquity, means there's this bent towards selfishness in us. We turn away from love, and that's the essence of sin. As soon as we step away from love, we've trespassed the only commandment we're given, which is to love. Love God with everything you are. Love your fellow human being the same way. And so as soon as we step away from love into, that's called sin. It means we're not good at hitting the bullseye of pure, unselfish generosity. Would anybody here confess that sometimes you have trouble being purely and continually unselfish and generous in every thought, action, and word? If that's you, then that's what the Bible calls a sinner. Now, you might be a sinner who's living by faith in the Son of God, you know, so your big S sinner has become a small s sinner. Like, you just do it sometimes, but it's not who you are, you know, that you're now the righteousness of God through faith in him. But still, this continual turning away from love kills us. That's the wages of sin. We work real hard to get our own way, and then it just kills us. And so God came to open the door to his heart and his life and give it to us. And it's really the desire of life, and it's the message of the scripture that the way home to this infinite love and this wonderful, unfiltered relationship with the love of God, the way is open. David was a guy who had a lot of issues in his life. You know, he was born under sketchy circumstances, according to Psalm 51. He was not conceived in the best of ways, and his brothers didn't like him, and his father didn't acknowledge him. Now, that's a lot going against you, and yet God had his hand on him. Anyway, David became the great king of Israel and the great psalmist. One of the psalms that is attributed to him is Psalm 118, and it has this, Psalm 118, verse 19, the cry of the human heart, open to me the gates of righteousness. Righteousness is perfect relationship. Righteous means you're okay with me and I'm okay with you, and there is nothing to hinder that relationship. Righteousness involves protecting and valuing and honoring relationships, but that's the essential meaning of the word righteousness. So God is righteous. He's perfectly righteous, meaning he's perfectly committed to maintaining a relationship with all of us. But when we're unrighteous, we don't know that, and we struggle with insecurity, rejection, rebellion, all kinds of unloving responses to this unconditional love of God. David cries out, "Open the gates of righteousness to me, and I will go through them, and I will praise the Lord." This is the gate of the Lord through which the righteous shall enter. And so there's a gate of righteousness where God says, come on in. And the pilgrims who would go up to Israel, up to Jerusalem for the great feast, would sing this on their way up to the temple. And they were thinking of the gates of righteousness as the temple doors. Well, I have good news for you, that the gates into God's presence are open everywhere. You don't have to go up to Zion, up to a physical temple in a physical city, but you can come to God through Jesus Christ wherever you are. So open the gates of righteousness, and I'll go through them and praise the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord through which the righteous shall enter. Verse 21, I will praise you, for you have answered me and have become my salvation. In other words, David sensed this, like, I need someone to rescue me from myself, to bring me through the gates of righteousness. Now he says, God, I'm gonna praise you. I'm gonna celebrate you because you heard me, you answered me, and you became something, my salvation. The interesting thing in the Hebrew language, the word for salvation there is Yeshua. You became my salvation, Yeshua. You became Jesus for me. Isn't that amazing? I mean, that's just such an amazing, this is a messianic psalm. You know, though David was writing it autobiographically, it was God was living his life in a shadow through the life of David. And he's living his life through his body in you and me. He's still telling his story. And so David's telling the story, and he's so amazed. Verse 22, he declares, the stone the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. This is the Lord's doing. It's marvelous in our eyes. And it's possible that David there is referencing his whole life. His family rejected him when he was, he was anointed by the prophet to be king, but then he was chased as a fugitive for the next 14 years. And even after he became king, the Philistine kings around him and the Syrian kings, they rejected him too. So they were the builders. And he says, the stone that the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. And David became the founding king of a great dynasty that goes on today in Jesus Christ, and under his rule became a great empire and actually fulfilled the promised borders given to Abraham in a generation. So this was the Lord's doing, marvelous in our eyes. So this is why the people would remember this and sing this antiphonally on their way up to the temple for the great feast. By the way, antiphonally, in case you don't know what that means, it just means one side would sing one line and the other side would sing another line. They were singing back and forth. It kind of was a connection there. And then they go on and says, so this, I mean, really what this psalm is declaring is that God has brought us into his new creation, because it's not just David that's the stone the builders rejected, but it's Jesus who was the stone the builders, the priests and leaders of his day rejected him, but he became the chief cornerstone on which our entire civilization is built and upon which every life that comes into relationship with God finds itself built. On this foundation, he's the cornerstone. And then there's the declaration of a new day. This is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. So when we come into this place of open doors of righteousness, we're experiencing the love of God. We're having our life built on the chief cornerstone, it brings joy and gladness into our heart. Now, is there suffering along the way? Yes, there's suffering in this world. We'll have tribulation. But Jesus says, be of good cheer. I've overcome the world. And so even in our deepest suffering, there's this internal fountain of joy that says, it's going to get better. It's going to get better. I have saved you. And you're not suffering needlessly. You're suffering for my sake. You're suffering with me. It's the fellowship of my suffering that I can demonstrate to you the power of my resurrection. This is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. And then it goes on to this next verse. Save now, I pray, Lord. Save now. How many want like the full measure of salvation right now? You want to be healed, you want to be delivered, and you want to be absolutely free. Save now, I pray, O Lord. O Lord, I pray, send now success or prosperity. And this is the save now becomes the Hosanna, Hosanna, that the people were crying as Jesus entered into Jerusalem. Somehow they sensed something that they had, they didn't fully comprehend it, but they sensed it and responded to it. Have you ever responded to something you didn't fully understand, but you felt it? You felt a reality bigger than you are, and they cried out, Hosanna, Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. They were crying out this psalm, sensing him coming in to fulfill his destiny. Verse 25, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. We have blessed you from the house of the Lord. And so this is the reality. This is the mission that Jesus came to fulfill, to open the gates of righteousness. He's the message of God. He's the God spoke it many times in different ways through different prophets, and none of them were capable of communicating who God fully was. And because he's infinite and we're finite, it's like our minds can't comprehend. So he uses different metaphors. He's creator, he's Lord, he's physician, he's shepherd, he's farmer, he's light, he's fire, he's the eternal one. But in these last days, he spoke to us in his Son, and in the Son, we discover that he's primarily the Father. And not only that, he's a good Father. Not only that, he's a loving and good Father. And so in these last days, he's spoken to us in his Son. That's his final message. And in Jesus, we see the heart of the Father. We see the activity of the Father. We see the response of the Father toward sinners. And we see the response of the Father toward religious legalists and hypocrites. You know, they were the only ones he was ever mad at. You know, the sinners, he said, hey, I want to come to your house for a party tonight, because his presence changes everything. Now, So he comes, and he comes as a baby. He comes as Jesus, and the name Jesus means salvation. It means God is my rescue. God will save me. God will rescue me. God will heal me. God will deliver me. And so when Mary became pregnant by the Holy Spirit and Joseph was in turmoil, the angel appeared to him in a dream and said, Joseph, don't be afraid to marry her, because it's true. And I want you to name her son Jesus, Yeshua, for he will save his people from their sins. What was the harm of sin is it kills us. The harm of sin is it takes us away from love. So he's going to open the door of righteousness, bring us back to love. He's Jesus. He's also the Lamb of the world. And his cousin, John, the baptizer, saw him far off, and he said, behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. So Jesus becomes the fulfillment of the priestly rituals, the sacrifices, and the feasts that that by which Israel would maintain a shadow of a relationship with God. I mean, they were related to him, but it wasn't in the fullness of his desire. So now when he sees Jesus, he sees this cousin of his, this relative, maybe second cousin, I don't know what level of cousin he was, but he says, you know, he says, behold, this is Yeshua. He's the Lamb of God, and he will take away the sins of the world. Now, isn't that amazing? John writes later in 1 John that he wasn't just the propitiation, the atoning sacrifice for our sins, but for the sins of the world. In other words, he absorbed in himself, he made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we could become the righteousness of God. He absorbed in himself all the sin of the entire world, not just the ones who chose him, but the whole world. And he carried it away so that it's no longer an issue in the relationship between you and God. This is wonderful news. The gates are open. Not only that, so he did that in his death. In his death, he carried away the sin, the accumulated sin of the human race, and it was thrown into a sea of forgetfulness. And God doesn't remember our sins again. The devil remembers them, and he's continually accusing us before God with them. And he's like, I don't know what you're talking about. I don't remember any of that. You know, it's really good news. Not only that, he destroyed death in his dying. Paul writes to Timothy, 2 Timothy 1, verse 8, therefore do not be ashamed of the testimony about our Lord, nor of me, his prisoner, but share in the suffering for the gospel of the power of God, by the power of God. In other words, he's saying, Timothy, don't hide from those difficult times. Don't hide from persecution. Don't hide from hostility. Just figure what? I am just sharing in the suffering of Christ for the glory of God. I'm in the fellowship of his suffering so that I can experience the power of his resurrection. And he saved us, verse 9, he set us free and called us to a holy calling to live a holy life, not because of our works, but because of his own purpose and grace, which he gave us in Christ Jesus before the ages began, and which now has been manifested through the appearing of our Savior, who abolished death. I like that term. He abolished death. Why don't we all say it together? He abolished death. That's wild. Now, do people still die? Yes, but death no longer functions in the way it formerly did. Because if you're in Christ, to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. So death is no longer a separation, it's a reunion. Death is no longer something to be feared. It's something to be treasured and anticipated as your reward. Come on. It's like, this is amazing. He made it so death no longer functioned as the great penalty, but he made it the great reward. He abolished death and he brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. The word immortality could also be translated incorruptibility. That means when you die, you won't stink. It means, that's a wild thought. Now your body might not do so well, but a few saints, I mean, there are saints today whose bodies are unembalmed and as soft and pliable and pleasant as they were when they were alive. And it's true. We, you know, that's like a whole different subject. So, but I just throw that out there to make you curious. But his death is his gift. You know, when he's dying, he's not dying for himself. He's dying for us. And he said this in John 10. He said, look, nobody takes my life from me. I lay it down of my own accord. I have the authority to lay it down and the authority to take it up. So what was he doing when he died? It's like, so in other words, when he was arrested, when he stood before Pilate, when he was being whipped, when he was being nailed to the cross, it wasn't something happening to him. It was something he was choosing. And in choosing that, he was choosing our punishment. He took our punishment so we could have his reward. He took, initially he took the place of Barabbas, didn't he? Like Barabbas deserved to be crucified, and Pilate said, why should this innocent man die? But there was a demonic hatred against him that cried out, crucify him, crucify him. It was perfect, because that was his plan anyway. Sometimes the devil doesn't know what God is up to, and if he did, he wouldn't do what he did. And so what did he do when he laid down his life? It was the gift of giving us eternal life. And this is a quote from the Paschal homily of St. John Chrysostom, who was a preacher in Constantinople in the late 300s, okay? And one of the great preachers of the church. In fact, this exact passage is often declared in Orthodox churches on Orthodox Sundays, which this year happens to be today. And so we were thinking we could have warmer sunrise services if we always pick the Orthodox Sunday, because it always comes later than the Western Easter. But anyway, so here's what St. John Chrysostom said. As he dies, he destroys death. That's a good line, isn't it? As he dies, he destroys death. Let no one fear death, for the Savior's death has set us free. Let no one fear death, for the Savior's death has set us free. God, just deliver us all right now from the fear of death. The fear of death will cause us to make bad decisions every time. He that was taken by death annihilated it. By descending into hell, he made hell captive. He embittered it when it tasted its flesh, for it was abolished, for it was mocked, for it was slain, for it was overthrown, for it was bound with chains. It took a body and met God face to face. It took earth and met heaven. It took what was seen and fell upon what was unseen. Oh, death, where is your sting? Oh, grave, where is your victory? Christ is risen, and you are overthrown. Christ is risen, and the demons are fallen. Christ is risen, and the angels rejoice. Christ is risen, and life reigns. Christ is risen, and not one dead remains in the grave. For Christ, being risen from the dead, has become the first fruits of those who sleep. To him be glory and dominion unto the ages of the ages. Amen. So this is the gospel. The gospel that God created man in his own image, the image of love. Man turned away from perfect love, perfect relationship, which made him subject to death. So he could no longer live in the Garden of Eden, lest he reach out and in his rebellious state take from the tree of life and live forever. So he went out, but do you know what? God went out with him. And God never rejected him nor forsook him. God always turns toward us. We run from God and he runs after us. Isn't that good news? I mean, you know, he's always after us. When they went out from the garden, he gave them really nice clothes. He gave them leather clothes, you know, fur coats to keep them warm. And so he did this through the ages. He would come and he would plead with his people through prophets. In the fullness of time, he came to us in his son. He was born of a woman. He was born under the law to deliver those who were under the law and become salvation to all mankind. And so, you know, when he came, when Jesus was born, this little baby who needed to be held and nursed and comforted, he said, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. He didn't come in power. He came in a state that required human love. And I'm telling you, he's still looking for human love today. Isn't it odd? I mean, he came needing to nurse from Mary. He came thirsty for human love. He was formed by human love. He was formed by family, by Joseph and Mary. He was formed by community. He was formed, and he said, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. And so he reveals how much God loves human beings, how desirous he is that we would take him and treasure him and allow him to grow into the fullness of who he is in our life. Because sometimes when we first encounter God, we have a very infantile perception of him. And he allows that. We grow and grow and grow and grow in the knowledge of him. Because if we got it all from the beginning, we would be obliterated. We would just like, you know, we couldn't cope with it. And so Christ is formed in us. But when he came, he was the Word who had created the entire universe. And he comes to seek us. So sometimes even times in my own life, and thank God they're quite a few years ago, but times in my own life when I had intense and inexplicable suffering, and sometimes I would read the Word and it would like hurt me. And it was because, actually the Word wasn't hurting me, it was the way I understood the Word that was hurting me. My mind had to be open so I could perceive the loving kindness from beginning to end. But he seeks us and he heals us. He is the Word. He is the Word made flesh. Like, if you want to know what this Word is for, look at Jesus. He came to seek and save that which was lost, to restore everything that had been forfeited. He came to heal every disease. He took a boat trip across a lake in a storm to meet one demonized man and set him free. One man that nobody liked and everyone was afraid of. And this is the reality of God. He's not sitting on the throne waiting to punish you for all the things you did wrong. He's waiting to set you free. In fact, he's pursuing you. You can't run faster than his love travels, you know. And so if you run away, you'll find you ran into him. And so he does this, and he removes all the offense, and he forgives us, and we see this in his death so precisely. Here's the Sanhedrin, this group of Jewish elders. Some were political, most they were religious and political, and some were truly spiritual, but together as a group, they condemned him to an illegal death in an illegal trial. And they brought him before Pilate and manipulated Pilate in his own fear of death to put Jesus to death. And in all of that, was he angry? No, as they were nailing him to the cross, he said, "Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. Father, don't hold this to their account because they absolutely have no comprehension of the great thing they're doing. So forgive the drunken soldiers who beat me and spat upon me and caused extra suffering. Forgive the cruel, deceived, hate-filled men who cried out that I would be crucified instead of Barabbas. Forgive them all." Isn't this amazing? If you've seen me, you've seen the Father. At his extremity, he lets us do what we want with him. And yet we find out it's what he wanted us to do so he could set us free. Ah! You know, it's like, can we understand? He forgives the soldiers. He forgives the thieves. You know, and the thief crying out next, you know, there one thief is mocking him. The other thief says, "Hey, knock it off. And remember me when you come into the kingdom." And what does he say to him? He says, "Today you'll be with me in paradise." He didn't say, "Someday in the by and by, maybe in the resurrection, if you make it into the resurrection of the just, you might be." No, he said, "Today you will be with me in paradise." It's amazing. This is who he is. In his extremity as he's dying, he sees his mother and he says, "Woman, behold your son. I want to make sure you're taken care of." And he says to John, "Son, behold your mother. Take care of her." He made John the firstborn of the family, you know, to take care of the mom. And it's just like, do we understand who God is, or are we afraid of some scary, mean God in the sky who can't wait to hurt us? Well, what about when he turned his face from Jesus And on the cross, Jesus quoted Psalm 22. He only quoted the first line because he's dying by suffocation. But when he quoted the first line, he was quoting the whole psalm. It's as good as he could do. Could we give him a break? You know, like, and he cries out, "Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani? My God, why have you forsaken me?" So we have this whole doctrine that God the Father forsook him. But that's not the point of Psalm 22. The point of Psalm 22 is we feel forsaken, but we're not actually forsaken. He declares his own crucifixion in the psalm. David saw this. Maybe he was just describing his own suffering and being really dramatic about it. It's a good Jewish trait, you know, this dramatic, like, yeah, it's intense. But listen what he writes, verse 14, "I'm poured out like water. All my bones are out of joint. My heart is like wax. It's melted within my breast." Verse 16, "They've pierced my hands and feet." Verse 17, "I can count all my bones." Verse 18, "They divide my garments among them." Verse 19, "But you, O Lord, do not be far off. O you, my help, come quickly to my aid. I will tell of your name to my brothers in the midst of the congregation. I will praise you." And isn't he doing that around the world through his body? You and me, as we sing the praises of God, the good, good Father, we are fulfilling this psalm, Psalm 22, 22. Here's verse 24. "He has not despised nor abhorred the affliction of the afflicted. He has not hidden his face from him. But he has heard when he cried to him." And then this is stunning. "All the ends of the earth shall remember and turn to the Lord, and all the families of the nation, the goyim, shall worship before you." Do we believe this? Do we believe this? That all the ends of the earth shall remember and turn to the Lord. No matter what the newspaper says, no matter what North Korea does or ISIS does, or no matter what Trump does, or no matter what Obama did, or no matter whether the nations are righteous or unrighteous, this has no limitation on the promises of God, that all find their yes in Christ. And so by us, the amen is spoken, uttered to the glory of God the Father. And here's what it says: "All the ends of the earth shall remember and turn to the Lord." Can I hear an amen? "And all the families of the nations shall worship before you." Amen. Very good. I think that makes God happy. So, you know, he said, "I thirst." He said, "It's finished." He's thirsty. When he was a baby, he was thirsty. When he met the woman at the well, he was thirsty. On John 7, he said, "If anyone's thirsty, come to me." Like, he gets it. He likes your thirst for him. And here in his extremity, he cries out, "I thirst." He's dying of dehydration, of course. But someone can help him even there. And then John 19:30, great statement. "It's finished. It's paid in full. There is no debt remaining. The debt is erased. The handwriting that was against you, all the accusations of everything you did wrong and all the good things you didn't do, it's all erased. It's blotted out by his blood. And it's finished. And so when you come to God, he's not looking for you to check off a list of all the things you've done that have offended him. Yeah, you may be aware of that, so you just bring it to him and say, "Here, this was all paid for already at the cross. I confess it to you. It's gone." And he forgives us. If we say we have no sin, we make him a liar, and the truth is not in us. But if we come and we confess, "I did this and I did that and I did this and I did that," and there's a part of our conversion that is involved in confessing sin. And even if, like, I don't know about you, but there were times in the last 7 days when I didn't live in perfect love. A lot fewer than there used to be, but a lot more than I would like. And I bring those and say, "God, I was a selfish pig. God, I was proud. God, I was feeling rejected. God, I was, those are like your sins could be great. You know, they could be, God, I killed somebody. God, I committed adultery. God, I stole a bunch of money. Or they could be very minor, but our sin clouds our heart to the love of God. And so we just bring it to him. We say, God, that stunk. And he said, you're right. That's it. He's not mad. He's not offended. He just wants us to be clean. Isn't he good? You know, he's so good. And Jesus is the righteous one who's faithful and just to forgive us and cleanse us from unrighteousness so that we can go through the gates of righteousness. We can go in and praise his name. We can say, this is the day the Lord has made. I'll rejoice and be glad in it. You know, it's just, this is why he died and why he rose from the dead. See, if we think he just died for our sins and that killed him, we'll feel guilty eternally. But if we realized it was his gift to us, he just played on our inherent selfishness and knew there'd be enough selfish human beings to put him to death, then he could destroy death, annihilate hell, destroy him that had the power of death, and bring about a new day, the day the Lord has made. Ah, into your hands I commit my spirit. And then after he's risen, he appears to his friends. Like what? Peter was right. Peter was speaking to the Italians. The first people that got the gospel outside of Italy were outside of Israel were, it was a little bit of Italy. It was little Italy right there Palestine, Judea, whatever province it was at that time. But he goes to Cornelius' house and he tells him, he said, after he was killed, he rose from the dead and he appeared to men, not to everybody, but to those of us who knew him. And he ate and drank with us. Like this, the reality is, after all that, he still wants to come and enter into our human life, our family life, our social life, and he wants to be with us when we eat and drink. Is that a stunning reality of God? And so he comes, you know, and he comes to us in our need. Mary loved him so much. This is Mary Magdalene. She loved him so much. She's absolutely grief-stricken, even though things have been declared to her. It hasn't processed into her heart. And so he comes to her. First, an angel asks her, why are you crying, Mary? Why do you weep? And then she turns around, and there's Jesus, and he's not dressed like a rabbi. He's not wearing a suit, you know, like some preacher on Easter Sunday morning, but he's dressed like the gardener. He's dressed like the gardener. He's got his rake and his Farmer John's and straw hat, you know. And he says, woman, why are you crying? Whom do you seek? Sometimes we're seeking something that we are attached to, and God wants to give us something so much better. And then he says her name, Mary. She's no longer just woman, she's Mary. When she hears his voice call her name, there's something inside her that just melts, and she falls at his feet. And then he goes to his friends. He had this kind of, I did this message once on the practical jokes of the resurrected Jesus. But then he goes to the guys on the road to Emmaus, and they're really sad. And he says, what's going on, guys? And they talk to him and tell him. And then they break bread, and he's known to them at that moment in the breaking of bread, and he disappears like a mystery. Next time he shows up, these guys go find his disciples. They bring him into their locked room because they're afraid of the Jews, even though they're all Jews. They're afraid of the ruling class of the Jews, you know, the police class. And you know what he says to them? He says, peace. Peace to you. Shalom Aleichem. Like, it's all going to be okay, guys. And he said to them, why are you troubled and why do doubts arise in your hearts? That's a good question. Like, why do we get troubled? Anybody here been troubled? Anybody had doubts arise in your hearts? By the way, that falls short of the glory of God, you know. And so we just go, God, you know, deliver me from my doubts and my troubles and my turmoil. And he says, see my hands and my feet. It's I myself. Touch me. For see, a spirit doesn't have flesh and bones. And as you see, I have. And so when he said this, he showed, you know, he said, hey, look, guys, you know, you want to take a look? I'll show you. And then he says, by the way, have you got anything to eat here? Like, I worked up a real appetite. You know, I just destroyed death. And I, you know, I had to do all that suffering on the cross. And I was thirsty. You got anything? And they brought him some fish and he ate it. Said they brought him a piece of broiled fish. And he took it and ate it before him. This proves God's not a vegan. You know, if you want to be a vegan, that's okay. But there's, it's not like spiritually superior. He ate and Peter says he ate and drank with them. Why? Did he need to digest the calories to keep? I have no idea. He just wants to be with us when we eat and when we drink. And then he did something absolutely amazing. Verse 45, he opened their minds to understand the scriptures. He opened their minds to understand the scriptures. They had been reading the scriptures, they had been with him for 3 years, but now he does something, he opens this, there's a word used there for mind. In the New King James, it says he opened their understanding to comprehend the scriptures, but this word is nous, not the one you tie around your neck, but it has a different spelling, N-O-U-S. Kind of like Ewan's, but it's noose, okay? And it's not Ewan's. This word means it's the organ through which we perceive God and life. He says, I'm going to change the way you see everything. I'm going to change your filter. I'm going to adjust it. And from that point on, when they read the law, the prophets, and the writings, instead of seeing regulation, they began to get revelation. Instead of seeing all the things they were guilty of, they started seeing all the promises of God. Instead of seeing what failures they were, they began to see the greatness of the salvation they had been offered. And they began to see that God, that he had opened up the gates of righteousness. And you know, just a few words can change everything. This is a true story. 1815, Wellington, the great British general, went into Europe to fight Napoleon. Napoleon, who had founded this great empire, he had this grand army of France that had gone all over Europe and just whipped everybody, didn't have any defeats. And the English were fearful and they had alliances, so they sent their army into what today is Belgium, and they're at Waterloo in, you know, through miracles of weather and just plain, like, bad strategy on the part of the French, the English won. It was the first defeat of the Grand Army of France. And so the British were waiting in great apprehension to know how this battle had turned out. You know, they sent their best and their brightest into battle. They didn't know, you know, will it just continue? Will Napoleon come and conquer England? And so they were out on the white cliffs of Dover, you know, peering out at the sea, and it was a cloudy, foggy, stormy day. And through the storms, they saw a sailor on the bow of the first ship, and he had semaphore flags, and he was signaling the message. And here's what they got. They got Wellington defeated. And when we finished Wellington defeated, the clouds rolled back, and that's all they got. And they were so dismayed. And they sent riders throughout all of England giving the news that the English army had been defeated like every other army, that nothing could stop Napoleon and his pursuit of grandeur. And so they were all dismayed. And then a few hours later, the clouds lifted again, and there was the sailor again on the ship. Now it's closer, but he's giving the same signal, and it says, Wellington defeated the enemy. And those last two words changed everything, didn't they? And so, then they dispatched new riders, say, no, 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 you know, and so the mourning turned into gladness, and it's kind of, that's what the resurrection does, you know, it gives us the rest of the story, that he's opened the doors, he's made a way in so that we can live and not die. I'd like you to stand. The gates of righteousness are open. Will you go through them and praise him and thank him? And I just want to declare a couple things here. One is that if you've never come and surrendered your life to him, that's how we enter into the gates of righteousness. He said, I am the door, and you come in and go out through me. But we have to come to him. He is the resurrection and the life. Long before he died and was raised from the dead, he said this to Martha, the sister of Mary. Martha, I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me will, even though he dies, he will live. And Martha didn't understand it. You know, he's the way in to this unconditional, infinite love that we were created for. And so if you've never put your trust in him, you've never believed that he's God's gift to you, you've never confessed with your mouth, Jesus, you're the Lord of my life, then today is your chance. You can come in through the gates of righteousness. You can come in and praise his name. So I just want to give you an opportunity now to respond to that. If that's an urge you had, or maybe you once knew him. Maybe you were baptized as a baby, or maybe you were, you came to an altar call 10, 20 years ago, but you've been away and your heart's been hard, and you say, God, I want to come back in. I want to restore this relationship, the eternal life. Today's your day. So I want to ask you, if you wouldn't mind bowing your heads, and let's just pray, Holy Spirit, would you reveal how good God is? And if you say, I want to come in, I want to go through that door, I want to give my life to Jesus, then, and you know, every amazing good Christian, you know, wants to say that too every day. But if you've been away, if you've never been born again from God, I want you to lift your hand today. And it's just kind of, you're lifting your hand like, come and help me. Come and help me, God. Come and help me come in. Would you lift your hand? And just, yeah, there's nothing to be ashamed of. It's a good thing. He died for you. God bless you. Keep your hands up. Just not because we're needing that, but just because it's good. Like, hold your hand up until we're going to pray that he'll come and take you by the hand. God bless you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Just beautiful. Beautiful. So could we all say this together? Heavenly Father, I believe that Jesus Christ paid for my sins, that he's the Lamb of God, that he took away the sins of the whole world. Now take away my sin. Forgive me for the things I've done wrong. Forgive me for the things I knew I should do but didn't do. Remove this from me. Blot out the record of my transgression. And open the door for eternal life. I believe that Jesus Christ was raised from the dead, that he's Lord of all, that it's his name that saves me. I receive him. Come into my life, come into my heart, and be Lord. Establish a relationship. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Beautiful. That's awesome. So at the end, those ones who raised your hand, we're going to have some people. Actually, if the ministry team, if you guys would come up here now, that would be great. If you'd just be up here, because there's prayer for healing. And I want every one of you who raised your hands, I want you to come up and connect with one of these people up here. They're just going to confirm it to you. And we have free Bibles. If you don't have a Bible, there's some Bibles at the back there by the soundboard. And we want to get you started right. All the rest of you, and all of you, okay, it's all of us here. Let's declare this. Christ is risen.
Christ is risen.
Let's shout it. Christ is risen. And the demons are fallen.
Christ is risen.
And the angels rejoice.
Christ is risen.
And life reigns.
To him be glory
and dominion forever and ever.
Amen.
God bless you. So I just want to invite, if you raise your hand for salvation or rededication, come forward. If you have issues for healing, he is the healer, especially heart conditions. Just feel free to come forward. And just want to take some time. Just don't be in a hurry. Whoever came with you, they'll be happy to wait. I can guarantee that. Yeah, come on up. Come on up. The altar is open. And the rest of you, may God bless you. He is alive. Amen. Have a great Easter.